Thank you, friends, so much for inviting me on this occasion. Well, I come from Gujarat, which is supposed to be the most progressive and development state. And my friend, Mr. Pinto, mentioned about the revocation of the FCRA of my organization. That's a very minor issue. But the reason given by the central government was your activities are detrimental to national interest. Well, I think that's a very good, very correct perspective, because I have come to this conclusion that India, as India, we are one country, but definitely we have two nations. It's divided into two nations. If you go to the villages, the country is not ruled by constitution, it is ruled by caste. Why do I say so? In 1980, when I graduated and I wanted to join this work, my teacher, and I had big dreams of doing my PhD and becoming a scholar and all that, and my professor, he says, look, Martin, if you go for your higher studies, I guarantee that you will get a degree but no knowledge. Rather, if you go and live in the village for 2 years, I give you guarantee that you won't have a degree, but you will have knowledge. Now, choice is yours. And after my graduation, I never went for my further studies. I went and lived in the villages every week, 3 days and three nights. What did I see in the villages? Well, the man from the so-called upper castes, they entered any home they wanted and do anything with the Dalit women in broad daylight, and there was no protest. Sometimes the husbands who were there would walk out and tell the landlord that, please continue, sit in my house, I'll finish some work and come back. The law said that you must be paid 7 rupees for 8 hours of labor, but people were paid only 1 rupee. You couldn't ride a bicycle, you couldn't tuck your shirt in, you couldn't go in the village without a turban, and you can imagine all the things that we continue to hear even today. What can we do about this? I spoke to the people, the elderly people, and I asked them, please explain to me why this situation continues and why there is no protest. And they used to explain to me that many years back, when the gods had come on the earth, our forefathers were so bad that they threw stones at the god, and so we have got this fate. While the man from the upper caste, they were wise and they offered flowers to God, and that's why they're having all the privileges. The internalization of the caste in its full form, which made protest absolutely not possible. We are speaking about now, people will say, well, this is the story of about 1980. But in 2001, 2010, we did a major study about the prevalence of untouchability practices in Gujarat. Not a small study, 1,589 villages of Gujarat. 98,000 respondents. And so that people cannot say that this is an activist study, we invited scholars from the US, also Professor Thorat and Ghanshyam Shah from India. What does the result say? In 90.2% of villages, Dalits, though they are Hindus, they cannot enter temples. In 64% of villages, Dalits may be elected as sarpanches or the members of the village council. They will not be able to sit on the chair, or the water glasses will be separate for them. In 54% of the villages, Dalit children are seated in a separate queue during the midday meal. The government definitely was very annoyed with this study, and Mr. Modi at that time was the chief minister of Gujarat. The matter came to the Gujarat Assembly, and look how the politics happened. Nobody else was asked to speak, but only a Dalit elected member of the Legislative Assembly was asked to speak. And the man says, "I'm a Dalit. I'm born in Gujarat. I have never seen untouchability in my life." And the press comes back to me and says, "Mr. Macwan, this is what a Dalit MLA has to say." And I said, I perfectly agree with him that if this is coming from the floor of the assembly that there is no untouchability in Gujarat, I withdraw my study. But please abolish political reservations tomorrow. Let all the Dalit MLAs resign and fight election from a general seats. Well, next day all the MLAs got together and said there is some untouchability still left in Gujarat. A problem is, because of the reservation, there are 89 members of the parliament who are Dalits, but they are divided into 17 political parties. They will not come together whether it is a question of land alienation for Dalits or the continuous practices of manual scavenging or the rising atrocities in the country. Well, we are remembering Dr. Ambedkar today and his thoughts. Before independence, Ambedkar was an untouchable for the country. Post-independence, he is unavoidable. Dalits may be untouchable in the country, but 16.5% of Dalit votes are not untouchable. And all the political parties want that vote. Without that, they cannot win elections. And that's why Dr. Ambedkar has become very relevant. Certainly for Dalits, his thoughts are very relevant because that is the only moral inspiration that they can draw in the present situation. You have spoken about Gulana, 1986, where my colleagues were shot dead. But in 1992, I went to a village. The name is Virpur. And there's a pipeline which is laid by the government and opened without tape, a 4-inch diameter pipeline. And underneath there is a water hodge, a kind of built water pool. The Dalits, they are standing in a queue because there is very little water available for drinking. The other castes, they are sleeping peacefully at their homes. When the water comes, it is flowing from the pipeline. Dalits could not fill it up. They had to wait with their pots at a distance. The man from the dominant caste came, they filled up the water. The overflowing water fell in the tank. By the time the dominant caste had enough water, the water stopped. The only water now available was in the tank. Well, can the Dalits have that water? No, they cannot. The dominant caste would go home, get the buffaloes and cows. The buffaloes and cows will drink directly from the tank. After they are done, it was the turn of Dalits. Well, a year back, The country witnessed the flogging of 4 Dalit youth in public in Una, saying that you are killing a cow. The violence based on caste is nothing new to Gujarat. Equality is an ideal that we are looking for. Inequality is a reality. It's a fact of life. We tend to believe often that these incidents are isolated events, but they are not so. This is systemic. You protest against the non-payment of wages, there's bound to be violence. You try to sit on the chair in the panchayat, there's bound to be violence. You break the so-called caste law, there's going to be violence. It's systemic. There's a village in Gujarat which is historically very important called Ranpur, which was the epicenter of the national movement during the independence struggle. It divides the main Gujarat from the Saurashtra. About 42 scavengers, they came to us with a very, very silly demand. I have never seen such a silly demand in my life. My colleague was there and they said, we are made to work for 10, 12 hours, but it's okay, we have no complaints about it. The men are paid 32 rupees, women are paid 20 rupees or something, but we have no complaints. Our only complaint is, our brooms are broken. So when we clean the open defecated systems, the black soil and the urine, it all touches our hands and feet and our clothes. Can you get us new brooms? Well, the broom cost maybe about 2 rupees or 2.5 rupees. And my colleague said, that's very simple, let's go. And he led the group of people to the panchayat. But before they could reach the panchayat house, there was the house of the sarpanch. He's an industrialist having 3 factories in the village. And he shouted at top of his voice, hey, don't bring those bangadas here. Bangi in itself is a very derogatory term, and bangada is a further derogation. And later the panchayat gave in writing that we do not have the budgetary provision to buy the brooms, while the octroi income of that panchayat was 13 lakhs per month. Well, that really made me very angry, and we'll say, let's do something about it. I got 2 photographs, and before I could decide what to do, accidentally a man walked in my office, supposed to be a new resident editor of Times of India, and he says, Mr. Macwan, what is this? I said, that's called manual scavenging. What do you mean? You have manual scavenging in Gujarat? I said, every way. Well, that became the front page story in Times of India, followed by a national outburst for a couple of months. I saw in the villages, according to 2011 census, only 36% of Indian population has access to sanitation systems. Of 1.25 billion people, 74% people who don't have access to sanitation systems. So you can imagine what happens in bigger villages where there is no wasteland available. So in Ranpur, the government had appointed 2 plots of land with a boundary of maybe a feet or 2 feet high, one for the men and one for the women, where everybody would come and defecate in the morning, and then mainly the women because within the caste is the women who suffer much more than the man. All the dirty work is done by the women. So these women will come and sweep. The only technology they have is two plates by which they will lift the fecal matter, put it into their baskets, put it on the head and dump it outside the village. In the monsoon when it is raining, you can see the whole thing dribbling on their bodies and faces. In 1910, Gandhi was so upset about it that in Bombay he said, if at all I have to be born again, I would like to be born to a scavenger woman. The description that Gandhi had in 1910 about these conditions, living conditions of scavengers in Bombay, does not change after 80 years in Gujarat. The same conditions continue. We are talking about the Swachhata mission, building toilets. I have visited several villages in several districts. In the name of toilets, there's nothing but corruption. Toilets are built which are not usable. Big figures, but the scavenging continues. We made a beautiful film, and I see somebody there who was responsible for the film there. Lesser Human, which I would say everyone must see. With the first film, which shows living conditions of the manual scavengers in India. Again, the government was very upset with us. They're saying, you're shaming India. You're shaming India. And I remember the dialogue I had with the Indian ambassador in the Human Rights Commission in Geneva. In 2000, the United Nations was holding a conference, United Nations conference, against racism. And for the first time, we had taken the issue of the caste discrimination to the conference. Well, government of India said this should not be allowed on the agenda because this is internal matter of India. Well, we told the government that we could have easily said that the apartheid was the internal matter of South Africa. India should not have gone there. Or we should not have sent the peacekeeping force in Sri Lanka. That was their problem. Well, then the government changed the stance and says, well, caste is not race and this conference is about racism. Well, the conference is about discrimination. Somebody wakes me up at middle of the night and says, hey, from tomorrow, you are not under caste, you are under race. How is my situation going to change? Well, I cannot forget the remarks of the chief of the Vishwa Hindu Parishad during the conference, and he said, caste is our fundamental right. Mr. Giriraj Kishore. And Ambedkar said, he made remarks about Hinduism and its inability to change the social structures. He was very right. And please correct me if I'm wrong. The person who supported Ambedkar to give up Hinduism was also one of the Shankaracharyas, Dr. Kuttukoti, a man who had done his PhD from Washington University, and he told, when Ambedkar was doing temple entry agitation in Kalaram, and Dr. Kuttukoti had tried to assemble the Hindus, Orthodox Hindus, and tried to tell them that this is correct and we must, he was stoned. People threw stones at the Shankaracharya, and then Shankaracharya writes a letter to Ambedkar that you're banging your wall banging your head against the wall. Please go for a religion which is more dignified. What is our biggest challenge today? Untouchability is rooted in the notion of religion. People believe that they're doing nothing wrong by practicing untouchability. What they're doing is perfectly religious. And that's why most violence is in the arena of the so-called spirituality and the religion. Well, there are some gimmicks going on right now in the country when Mr. Yogi, he says Hanuman was a Dalit. A year back, Mr. Yogi was visiting a place in Uttar Pradesh, and his officials went and distributed soaps and shampoos to the Dalits there and said, wash your hair, wash your body and wash your clothes so that when you come to meet the chief minister tomorrow, the foul stench of your body will not reach the chief minister. Well, I realize that abusing someone is not a strategy. I would never do that. What we did in Gujarat was something very simple. We made a soap which was 125 kilos soap, 4 feet long and 2 feet wide, because we are celebrating 125th year of Dr. Ambedkar's centenary. And we inscribed Lord Buddha on the soap. And we showed it to the press, a lot of press publicity, and they said, what are you going to do with it? And we said, I want to send a message to Mr. Yogi that Kushinagar, where you distributed soaps and shampoos to Dalits, historically is a place where Lord Buddha had attained Nirvana. A man 2,500 years ago had fought the caste, had refuted the ideas of the Purva Janma and a Punar Janma. You are rewriting history in that place by saying that the untouchability must continue. So we think, we hope that this soap will clean your, not your body, but your mind. Yes. Well, we traveled with the soap. 46 of my colleagues by the same Sabarmati Express, which is infamous because of the Godhra riots, with the soap. They were asked to get off the train at Jhansi, about 700 policemen on the railway platform with the guns. You can't proceed. What is this? Well, it's a soap. So he asked the policeman, please get the soap down, but he, poor fellow, he could not carry because 125 kilos. 8 policemen went, got the soap down. When we opened the casket, the police people, who were very arrogant, they saw Lord Buddha. So they removed the caps and they did namaste to Buddha. And then they took selfie with the soap, and that spread across Uttar Pradesh and the whole country. Well, finally, the police were very friendly and they made arrangement in a special guest house and meals and everything, and said, sir, please try to understand, it's not safe. Well, we only wanted to give soap. If you receive the soap on behalf of the government, that's okay with us. You give us a receipt. The police gave us a receipt. The soap was received by them, and the police paid our ticket back. But that doesn't mean untouchability does not continue. I'm doing a book recently on the atrocities on Dalits in India. If you look at the statistics, almost 90% of the victims of rape, Dalit women who have been raped, their age is below 17 years. When I was in the village earlier, there were married women who were raped. immediately after they were married and come to the village. Or even now that happens on the border of Rajasthan, that when the Dalit men and the women, when they're in the house for the first night, the dominant caste go on the roof, they remove the tiles and they want to watch what's happening inside, even today. I came across a story in Uttar Pradesh that because most of these women or the young girls are raped while they go for open defecation, the fellows are waiting there early morning or late night. One woman who is so terrified, she has not gone for defecation for a year and a half. She has been defecating in her one-room house and the husband goes and throws it out. Well, when the story broke out, the government sanctioned one toilet for her. Well, I can go on. But I want to highlight one more issue here, and that starts with my understanding of the caste. Well, I was born in a family. My grandparents had converted to Christianity way back in 1910. But very poor family, and I started working as an agricultural laborer at the age of 7 or 8. I was earning 1 rupee per day. My friends in whose farm I was going to work, we used to play in the school but not allowed to play in the farm. And then the water was poured also from above in my hands. But at the age of 17, I accompanied my professors to the village to do a socio-economic survey of the Dalit conditions. Well, we finished the survey and I told that I want to have a look in the village. They took me around and I saw that, you know, castes remain segregated, housing colonies, separate wells, separate cemeteries, everything. But then what I saw, a beautiful museum of teacups. Outside every house, there was a teacup, either on the roof or under the roof or on the boundary wall. And I was amazed by this museum of teacups. And I said, what is that? And they said, it is called Ram Patar. Well, that's called holy, right? That's Lord Ram's vessel. Why it is stinking and dirty and kept outside the home? Why don't you wash it and worship in your family? Well, Martin, but you don't understand. You know, when we are the untouchables. So when we come to these houses of this caste for either labor or to get some wages or something, they will say, "Will you have some tea?" "Yes, master." "All right, remove your Ram Patar." So we remove that teacup, put it on the floor. They will pour tea from above. We drink it. Well, they pour some water, wash it, and we put it back for our brothers and sisters. I saw it for the first time at the age of 17 in a village. Well, we had a tour of the village, and then I came here with the Dalit Basti. Supposed to have lunch there. And my eyes saw that there were teacups also in the Dalit Basti. And I said, "Wait, I'm totally confused. You tell me that these teacups are maintained by the so-called dominant caste for Dalits. Now, what these cups are doing here?" And they said, "Look, Martin Bhai, we are Dalits, but we are the higher ones. So when the scavengers come to our houses, we can't offer them tea in our cups." Well, I learned my first lesson in life. We all love the caste system, and therefore we cannot defeat it. I've been in the villages all my life, 38 years, organizing people, fighting violence. At one time, we were filing about 1,500 legal cases a year. We had 18 lawyers. But in the meetings, the Dalit would shout, "Jai Bhim, Jai Bhim," and I asked them, "Do you study?" "Yes, yes, we're in the college, we are graduates. Will you tell me 5 sentences about Dr. Ambedkar and his work?" "No, he was a doctor." nothing beyond that. With the Dalits, a lot of anger against Gandhi. And believe me, I have been respected so much in Gujarat, but even I was not spared because I placed Gandhi's photo and his statue because his remarkable work against untouchability, though I personally have my disagreement for the role Gandhi played during the Pune Pact, the separate electorate. He used violence against Ambedkar. He forced Ambedkar to give up his views. That Gandhi called that his fast for calling of God, where it was a political issue. Yes. That doesn't mean that Gandhi practiced untouchability. 1915, we all know that he invited the Dalit family in his ashram. And everybody boycotted, including the milk fellow said, I will not give the milk, and the neighbor farmer said, I will not give you drinking water, and the donation stopped. But Gandhi said that family will live here until a day's ration was left. And Gandhi said, if no more donations come, we'll shift the ashram to the Valmiki colony, but this family cannot go away from here. But in Pune Pact time, his role was controversial. But I explained to my colleagues, the community, that we cannot throw baby with the bathwater. We have to see history in this perspective. We have to evaluate people in the time frame and in context. Lastly, I want to say, caste prejudices are interwoven in the literature. Look at the books for the children, the curriculum, we'll find it all there. Dr. Ambedkar's message and his last unfulfilled dream that he left was the annihilation of caste. I'm very worried that sometimes even Dalits, we fall short to respect Ambedkar's vision of annihilating caste. This subcaste discrimination is rampant among the Dalits also. I think, let me end this, my talk here, by saying that Ambedkar had a vision. He believed it is not the religion which is going to bring a solution to the problem. It is education. Shikshit Bano. It is organization. During my years association with the movement, I have come to define Dalit as not an identity of people who belong to a caste. I upheld that Dalits are all those who believe in equality. Dalits are those who believe in equality, Dalits who practice equality, and Dalits are those who protest inequality. Thank you so much for listening to me. I can go on. But I want to highlight one more issue here, and that starts with my understanding of the caste. Well, I was born in a family. My grandparents had converted to Christianity way back in 1910. But very poor family, and I started working as an agricultural laborer at the age of 7 or 8. I was earning 1 rupee per day. My friends in whose farm I was going to work, we used to play in the school, but not allowed to play in the farm. and then the water was poured also from above in my hands. But at the age of 17, I accompanied my professors to the village to do a socio-economic survey of the Dalit conditions. Well, we finished the survey and I told that I want to have a look in the village. They took me around and I saw that, you know, castes remain segregated, housing colonies, separate wells, separate cemeteries, everything. But then what I saw, a beautiful museum of teacups. Outside every house, there was a teacup, either on the roof or under the roof or on the boundary wall. And I was amazed by this museum of teacups. And I said, what is that? And they said, it is called Ram Patar. Well, that's called holy, right? That's Lord Ram's vessel. Why it is stinking and dirty and kept outside the home? Why don't you wash it and worship in the way in your family? Well, Martin, but you don't understand. You know, when we are the untouchables. So when we come to these houses of this caste for either labor or to get some wages or something, they will say, "Will you have some tea?" "Yes, master." "All right, remove your Ram Patar." So we remove that teacup, put it on the floor. They will pour tea from above. We drink it. Well, they pour some water, wash it, and we put it back for our brothers and sisters. I saw it for the first time at the age of 17 in a village. Well, we had a tour of the village, and then I came here with the Dalit Basti. Supposed to have lunch there. And my eyes saw that there were teacups also in the Dalit Basti. And I said, "Wait, I'm totally confused. You tell me that these teacups are maintained by the so-called dominant caste for Dalits. Now, what these cups are doing here?" And they said, "Look, Martin bhai, we are Dalits, but we are the higher ones. So when the scavengers come to our houses, we can't offer them tea in our cups." Well, I learned my first lesson in life. We all love the caste system. And therefore, we cannot defeat it. I've been in the villages all my life, 38 years, organizing people, fighting violence. At one time, we were filing about 1,500 legal cases a year. We had 18 lawyers. But in the meetings, the Dalit would shout, "Jai Bhim, Jai Bhim," and I asked them, "Do you study?" "Yes, yes, we're in the college, we're graduates. Will you tell me 5 sentences about Dr. Ambedkar and his work?" No, he was a doctor. Nothing beyond that. With the Dalits, lot of anger against Gandhi. And believe me, I have been respected so much in Gujarat, but even I was not spared because I placed Gandhi's photo and his statue because his remarkable work against untouchability, though I personally have my disagreement for the role Gandhi played during the Pune Pact, the separate electorate. He used violence against Ambedkar. He forced Ambedkar to give up his views. That Gandhi called that his fast for calling of God, where it was a political issue. Yes. That doesn't mean that Gandhi practiced untouchability. 1915, we all know that he invited the Dalit family in his ashram. And everybody boycotted, including the milk fellow said, "I will not give the milk," and the neighbor farmer said, "I will not give you drinking water," and the donation stopped. But Gandhi said that family will live here until a day's ration was left. And Gandhi said, "If no more donations come, we'll shift the ashram to the Valmiki colony, but this family cannot go away from here." But in Pune Pact time, his role was controversial. But I explained to my colleagues, the community, that we cannot throw baby with the bathwater. We have to see history in its perspective. We have to evaluate people in the time frame and in context. Lastly, I want to say caste prejudices are interwoven in the literature. Look at the books for the children, the curriculum, we'll find it all there. Dr. Ambedkar's message and his last unfulfilled dream that he left was the annihilation of caste. I'm very worried that sometimes even Dalits, we fall short to respect Ambedkar's vision of annihilating caste. This subcaste discrimination is rampant among the Dalits also. I think, let me end this, my talk here, by saying that Ambedkar had a vision. He believed it is not the religion which is going to bring a solution to the problem. It is education. Shikshit Bano. It is organization. During my years association with the movement, I have come to define Dalit as not an identity of people who belong to a caste. I upheld that Dalits are all those who believe in equality. Dalits are those who believe in equality, Dalits who practice equality, and Dalits are those who protest inequality. Thank you so much for listening to me.